So thank you very much. Our journey is going on. So now we move on to the third topic, mind and its mysteries. Part of it has been talked by me in the plenary session of Asian Philosophy Conference, but much has been left out. So I request my another colleague, Swami Kanthi Anandji, to dwell on certain important aspects and before we open out to the questions for around 8 minutes.
Man or man ka rahasya. Man ek aisi cheez hai jo kahe ki hum ye pure sharir ka raja hai, raja. एक शब्द में हम मन कहते हैं, मगर ये मन है वो हम कैसे जानेंगे? तो हर एक संयोग में, हर एक परिस्थिति में, जैसे जैसे परिस्थिति बदलती है वैसे वैसे हमारे विचार भी बदलते हैं. और सबसे बड़ी गलत मान्यता क्या है कि हम विचार कर सकते हैं, मैं अच्छा विचार कर सकता हूं, मगर हमें पता नहीं है कि जैसे संयोग हमें प्राप्त होते हैं उनके आधार पर हमारे विचार चलते हैं. तो मन एक ग्रंथियों का बना हुआ है और उसमें से संयोग के आधार पर विचार चलते हैं. मन का धर्म है निरंतर तरह तरह के विचार करना. और एक ऐसी भी मान्यता है कि मेरा मन इधर उधर भटकता है. वास्तव में मन कभी भी शरीर के बाहर निकल नहीं सकता. जो इधर उधर भटकता है वो चित्त है. चित्त वृत्तियां जो हमारी है उनका धर्म है, जहां भी हमारी सुख की मान्यता है तो चित्त वृत्तियां अपने आप उधर चली जाएगी. और चित्त वृत्तियां हमारे शरीर के अंदर भी भटकती हैं. शारीरिक कोई भी पीड़ा या दर्द है तो बार बार हमारा चित्त उधर चला जाएगा. चित्त जो है वो दो शब्द से बना है, दर्शन और ज्ञान. विनाशी वस्तु का हमें अगर दर्शन है तो ज्ञान का जो परिणाम है वो विनाशी की ओर ही जाएगा. और उसका परिणाम जो है वो आदि, व्याधि और उपाधि है. और अगर हमें सत का यानी कि अविनाशी तत्व का हमें दर्शन होता है तो उसके परिणाम स्वरूप ज्ञान भी ऐसा ही होगा. और इसके परिणाम स्वरूप परमानंद रहेगा. इसीलिए हम हर एक जीव मात्र के अंदर जो आत्म तत्व विराजमान है उसका हम दर्शन करते हैं, इसका हमें ज्ञान हुआ है, तो हम सत चित आनंद कहते हैं। तो आनंद वो परिणाम है। और जब हमें हर एक परिस्थिति में प्रॉफिट लॉस बताता है वो बुद्धि है। हम कहीं भी जाएंगे, किसी भी परिस्थिति में, चाहे बस में जाए, चाहे प्लेन में जाए, कार से जाए, कहीं भी जाए, मगर हमारे जो बुद्धि का धर्म है, वो बुद्धि का धर्म है निरंतर हमें प्रॉफिट लॉस बताना। शास्त्र का जो ज्ञान है वो ज्ञान वो बुद्धिजन्य ज्ञान है। वो प्रवचन देने में, वो वार्तालाप करने में वो बहुत अच्छा है, मगर जहाँ तक हमें हमारे स्वरूप का ज्ञान नहीं है, मतलब मैं कौन हूँ इसका ज्ञान नहीं है, वहाँ तक बुद्धि से जो जाना है वो अहंकारी ज्ञान है, जो जानने से हमें ऐसा भीतर महसूस होता है कि मैं कुछ जानता हूँ, मैं कुछ हूँ, इसकी वजह से वो बुद्धि जन्य ज्ञान है, या उसे हम शास्त्र ज्ञानी कह सकते हैं। और आत्मा का ज्ञान जो है उसे अनुभव ज्ञान कहते हैं। और वो अनुभवी ज्ञान क्या है? वो हर एक परिस्थिति में, हर एक संयोग में हमें वो समाधान देता है, हमारे मन को हर एक परिस्थिति में जो समाधान देता है वो ही वास्तव में समाधि है, और वही वास्तव में आत्मज्ञान है। बुद्धि क्या है? आत्मा का जो परमात्म प्रकाश है वो बुद्धि अहंकार के माध्यम से जो लाइट बाहर आता है वो बुद्धि है। और जब अहंकार नहीं होता है तो निरअहंकारी पुरुष को आत्मा का जो प्रकाश है वो एज इट इज आता है, और उसको भी ये जगत क्या है, ये कैसे चल रहा है, इसकी वास्तविकता क्या है, वो समझ में आती है। तो अहंकार, अहंकार का मतलब क्या है? वास्तव में मैं कौन हूं वो जानता नहीं है, और जो मैं नहीं हूं उसे मैं हूं मानता है, वो अहंकार है। मतलब जो हो रहा है उसे मैं कर रहा हूं ऐसा आरोपित भाव करना, वो अहंकार है। तो मन का सबसे बड़ा रहस्य यही है कि जैसे जैसे उसके धर्म बदलते जाते हैं वैसे हम उसको मन से जानते हैं। भटकता है तो वो चित है, प्रॉफिट लॉस बताता है वो बुद्धि है, और मैं हूँ वो अहंकार है। तो ये अंतस्करण जो है वो अपने धर्म के अंदर ही है, मगर हमारा जो धर्म है, आत्मा का जो धर्म है, ज्ञाता दृष्टा, अगर वो ज्ञाता दृष्टा स्वभाव प्रकट होता है तो मन को और उनके ये सारे रहस्य को हम मुक्तता से, आनंद से जान सकते हैं। जय सच्चिदानंद।
थैंक यू वेरी मच कांति आनंद जी फॉर नाइसली पुटिंग द things. Now we are open for questions. I hope there should be many questions in this area because it's an area of mystery. If there are no questions, I can directly straight away hand over to Paneerselvam ji. They could not understand the Hindi, and I apologize for that. But please, Sohanraj ji. Since there is a time saved, as there are no questions, I can give it to him before moving to next speaker, Shri Kala ji. For the benefit of Paneerselvam ji and Shri Kala ji, I can just briefly translate what Kanti.
I understood.
You understood. Okay. So shall I? That's okay. Later on we can do. Thank you.
Adarniya Swami Kantyanand ji ne bade sundar dhang se man aur chitt ki baat batai.
Please speak in English.
So and actually he Kantyanand ji has told the difference of the what is mind and chitt, that means what is the consciousness. So mind actually flickers. It has got taking whatever the our senses take from the outside, that they give to the mind and mind take the decision. Another mind, what does present, past and future, this has go to the mind. But mind is not all. The disturbances, turbulences which come not only through the mind, but is the from the chit also. So he actually told main thing, the ego is the main thing. To know our existence, to have the self-realization, this ego comes in between. And ego actually prevents us to go to our natural existence. And he has also narrated the Dada's whole, this holistic science is take care of everything, every human being, every creature of the total cosmos. But the thing is to that, he emphasized that our main motto is to know who am I. And when this question starts, when a man starts, who am I, then philosophy also starts. We teach our students that from where the philosophy starts. Philosophy starts when we start thinking, who am I, from where I came, and from where I am to go. That is the origination of the philosophy. So he has nicely put the difference of this mind and consciousness. We are understand it. When we understand in between, this come the ego. His emphasis was to reduce, to nullify, to vanish the ego. Or when it is vanished, we can reach near and near to our pure soul. Like that.
Yeah, please. We are ready. We can have time for. Yeah, please.
No, the question came to me, and then you just.
I didn't see.
Anyway, it's about what we talked about. The model of Antaskaran, or which we Kanti Ananji described, is what Dada has given us. It can't be proven, you know. And there are many other models of mind, Antaskaran, in Western world.
Yeah, all right.
So how do we say this is the right one, or this is one of the right one?
Very simple. See, the whole human life is ongoing experiment. And for the experiment, there are two things, experiment and experimenter. If my understanding is working right for me and giving me the right results, it has to be the right fundamental. Very simple. If it is not working right for me, it may not be right. So I think this is how we go. And as he said, everything starts with looking inside. The whole world is tuned to look outside. But first lesson of this holistic science is learn to look within. And when I start looking within, I can immediately see that there are thoughts, there is wandering of chit, profit and loss, judgmental and emotional aspects, ego. I can see for myself. There is no need to go out. This is the biggest laboratory. With some guidance, I can observe for myself. I think that's the whole. And two more points I would like to add, because of time probably he has not been able to. Ego is not only a word. It has a scientific thing. When the conscious, it is an element with its own innate properties and phases, as well as matter with its own existential substance or dravya, innate properties and matter, they have come together. The third extra special properties do get generated. And as long as there are bhranti or layers, or I don't know, so it has come as ego and all anger, greed, pride, deceit, and everything, which is neither the innate property of pure self, neither the innate property of matter, but they have come as extra special properties. And that is the link which is responsible for causing or new bindings or new karma bindings. So that is, but how we can get rid of it is by knowing who am I and who is the doer or how the things are getting done. Second thing, when the Krishna says in Gita, Sarva dharman parityajya mam ekam sharanam vraja. So which paradharma or the other's properties or innate properties he wants us to live and which way he wants us to come into swadharma. Traditionally, I will feel that he wants me to leave Jainism and Shaivism and go to him, and I went, but my work is not getting done. So he says, I'm not telling you that. The five karmendriyas, five gnanendriyas and mind, they are all in their innate properties or dharma. I not knowing who am I is not in my dharma. So these are some subtle aspects. Please.
My name is Prem Kumar. I'm from Bangalore. Is ego is against enlightened living?
Ego against?
Ego. Huh? Ego. Huh? Is against, I mean, is it the block between the self-realization? To the self-realization?
Yeah, I would put it other way around. As long as, see, body is there, the existential state, ego is going to be there. As long in a relative living, I may make positive use of ego or negative use of ego. So if I want to become happy, use positively. Ego is not a problem. Problem is ignorance of my own real self, which is giving rise to ego. So ego says, what can I do? You know yourself and I'll go away. So yes, but the root cause is ignorance of the self, as I understand. So is it all, or shall I move to next topic, or something more, please?
This whole discussion that we are having, in that discussion, when I hear it, I'm hearing it and absorbing it through my ego sense. And all the applications that I may have out of this discussion and understanding also is with ego sense. There is no way I can avoid that. Self-realization is outside ego sense. Then how do I live in the world?
कांतियानंद जी, आप कुछ जवाब देना चाहेंगे इसका? मैं हिंदी करके देता हूँ आपको, कि ये बोल रहे हैं कि मैं जो कुछ सुनता हूँ, समझता हूँ, करता हूँ, वो मेरे अहंकार के माध्यम से हैं, और मेरा स्वभाव सेल्फ रियलाइजेशन तो अहंकार से बाहर है, तो कोई रास्ता है कि मैं दुनिया में किस तरह से जीऊँ? आपके लिए मैंने हिंदी करके दिया. एंड आई वॉज टेकिंग ओवर फॉर द प्लीज. आप हिंदी में जवाब दे सकते हैं, मैं इंग्लिश कर लूँगा उसका.
इंद्रियों का जो धर्म है, वो इंद्रियों का सभी धर्म को जानना, वही हमारा ज्ञाता दृष्टा स्वभाव है. उसमें ईगो बाधा नहीं करता है, क्योंकि ईगो जो है एक डिस्चार्ज ईगो है, कि जिससे हमारे ये शरीर की छवि क्रियाएं हो रही है, जिसे हम प्रारब्ध कर्म भी कह सकते हैं. मगर एक ईगो वो है कि मैं कुछ भी नहीं कर रहा हूं, फिर भी मैं करता हूं, ऐसा जो आरोपित भाव है, वो ईगो बाधा है, जिससे नए कर्म बंधन होता है. तो जब सेल्फ रियलाइजेशन होगा, या हो गया है तो जो डिस्चार्ज ईगो है वो बाधा नहीं बनता है, क्योंकि हम जो भी सुनेंगे जो भी देखेंगे वो सभी डिस्चार्ज ईगो से ही होगा। मगर आँख देखती है, भीतर एक ऐसा भी एक मान्यता वाला स्वरूप है, मैं देख रहा हूँ, वो सब गलत नहीं है। आँख देख रही है वो आँख का धर्म है, मैं देख रहा हूँ वो अंतस्करण का धर्म है, मान्यता का है। और ये सभी धर्मों को जो जानता है वो आत्मधर्म है।
आप जो बात कर रहे हैं भाई साहब, उसमें एक कंडीशन आपने रखी कि जब आत्मज्ञान होता है उसके बाद में डिस्चार्ज ईगो हम कह सकते हैं।
हाँ बराबर।
अगर मुझे आत्मज्ञान नहीं हुआ है,
हाँ तो आत्मज्ञान नहीं हुआ है तो चाहे अच्छा देख रहे हैं या बुरा देख रहे हैं, या अच्छा कर रहे हैं या बुरा कर रहे हैं, या धर्म कर रहे हैं या अधर्म कर रहे हैं, सब ही बंधन है। क्योंकि जो हो रहा है, इट हैपन्स, उसको हम मान रहे हैं, मैं कर रहा हूँ, वही ईगो है।
सो इनका सवाल बहुत मार्मिक है, बहुत ज़रूरी है, तो लास्ट में मैं एक दो वाक्य ऐसे कह सकता हूँ। इसीलिए बोला कि जगत के लिए कुछ, सबके लिए आत्मज्ञान संभव नहीं है, तो मैं दो चीज़ कर सकता हूँ कि मेरे ईगो को पॉजिटिवली यूज़ करूँ, मेरे मन वचन का ऐसे सभी को सुख पहुँचे, किसी को दुख न पहुँचे, ओब्लाइजिंग नेचर। इसीलिए हमने व्यवहार से शुरू किया था जहाँ ईगो बेनिफिशियल रूप से काम करता है। ईगो अकेला कोई गलत चीज़ नहीं है, ईगो सबसे ऊंची स्टेज तक, वासुदेव नारायण और 63 उत्तम पुरुष जो माने गए वहाँ तक ईगो का रोल है कल्याण स्वरूप में। सिर्फ एब्सोल्यूट होते हैं तभी वो संपूर्ण चला जाता है, वहाँ तक ईगो हायर स्टेट में जा सकता है, एक चीज़। दूसरी चीज़, जब मैं समझता हूँ कि कैसे हो रहा है तो मैं निमित्त भाव में आता हूँ, क्या करता हूँ, और ये दो चीज़ से, पॉजिटिव यूज़ और निमित्त भाव, जगत में मेरे जीवन के लिए जो जरूरी है वहाँ तक मैं पहुँच सकता हूँ। थैंक यू वेरी मच, एंड वी मूव टू द नेक्स्ट टॉपिक। आई इन्वाइट डॉक्टर श्रीकला नायर टू हैव हर रिफ्लेक्शंस ऑन दिस एज वेल एज हर ओन न्यूट्रल रिफ्लेक्शंस अबाउट द थिंग्स।
प्लीज अंडरस्टैंड दैट दिस इज जस्ट अ रिस्पॉन्स टू व्हाट आई हैव हर्ड दिस पास्ट टू डेज, एंड आई हैव बीन हियरिंग इट ड्यूरिंग दिस राउंड टेबल। So I have titled it as Exploring Some Insights of Dada Bhagwan on the Real and the Relative. Transition from Krama Vijnan to Akrama Vijnan, the spontaneous knowledge, what I would understand as the Akrama Vijnan, as the spontaneous knowledge that one should aspire for, to conceive the intricate nature of reality and the interrelation between God, word and soul, seems to me the axis around which Dada Bhagavan's thoughts revolve around. Krama Vijnan is a term he uses to refer to disciplined approach to reality. You undergo various types of disciplines, and in a systematic way, you try to reach up to reality. The term seems also, this Krama Vijnan is a term that he uses for to refer to various things. The term seems handy for him to refer to the analytic approach to nature adopted by contemporary physical science, a destructive way of understanding reality, to use his own phrase. Krama Vijnan, according to Bhagavan, consists of findings of the intellect. He says the use of the intellect takes you to disaster, where the subject takes up active agentship. You think, I am the one who thinks and I am the one who conceives the cause-effect relation which brings about various changes and happenings in the world. While in Akrama Vijnan, the agent is a non-performer. The findings of the intellect to him is divisive and partial, while Akrama Vijnan gives a holistic understanding of reality. The characteristics of Akrama Vijnan matches to me to my mind, more with that of the Sthita Prajna Lakshana, the characteristics of Sthita Prajna, beautifully related by Lord Krishna in the second chapter of Bhagavad Gita. Particularly, it is very, very striking that since he uses, he refers to Vitaraga, you know, Vitaraga Bhayakrodha Sthitadhi Muniruchyade, as Lord Krishna describes the status of Sthita Prajna to the innocent question that comes from Arjuna. Sthitadhi kim prabhasheda kimasida kim rajeda kim. Does he sit? Does he walk like us? To this, then Lord Krishna comes out with series of characteristics of Sthita Prajna, and most of the characteristics of Jnani that Dada Bhagavan speaks about finally matches with the characteristics of Sthita Prajna to mind, particularly Vidaraga and Aparigraha. Though to me, this term Aparigraha seems to have been borrowed from Jainism. Extending further on the characteristics of Jnani, he describes him as one whose thought, word, and deed are well coordinated. You would have heard even earlier speakers did make a mention about this necessary coordination that we need to have between a thought, word, and a deed. Many contemporary thinkers have explicated this as the tapas of our times. Today we don't have forests, nor do we have disposition to undergo penance like our ancestors. But then, the tapas that we need to have in Kali Yuga, it has been said, is to achieve this coordination between the thought, word, and deed. Here I am reminded of Jiddu Krishnamurti, who says that violence, you see that there is violence in the external world. Actually, the violence arises in ourselves first. And how does the violence arise in ourselves? When you do not have this coordination between the thought, word, and the deed, your doxas, you have a doxastic system, a belief system. And you, when you do violence to that, when you believe something and you speak something else and act in a very different order, you're doing violence to yourself. And it is this violence that arises in the individual gets spread in the society. And precisely Dada Bhagavan also speaks about this. He says that there are three causes for dukkha or sorrow, and they are adhi, vyadhi, and upadhi. Adhi arises, the anxiety arises out of our belief that we will be able to fix things as we desire. And vyadhi, of course, is the disease. The whole thing, adhi, vyadhi, and upadhi are arising out of our understanding that we can fix the things in the world, and our intellect is able to encompass the world as it is. Even from a global perspective, holistic approach seems to be the need of the heart. It is not only from India. Of course, there are various modes of thinking today available in the name of holistic approach to reality. But from a global perspective also, we have contemporary phenomenologists like Malaponti, who gives a critique of modern science for borrowing the Cartesian dictum of body as a machine, which is dichotomous to the psyche. As you all know, Descartes make a division between the body, the psyche, and the somatic functions as being distinct. He, I am referring to Malaponti, rightly points out the need of replacing it with the notion of a lived body. A body is a lived body in which, and please remember that in our Ayurvedic system, we always consider a lived body for treatment, in which there is an integration of psychosomatic exercises. Dada Bhagavan goes one step ahead of Malaponti and calls to integrate the spiritual along with the psyche and the physical. While the West stops with the mental, we are ancient philosophers as well as the contemporary thinkers bravely march ahead to encompass the spiritual as well. In this presentation, I also wish to suggest that this order, I am referring to the holistic center, may take serious attempts to unearth the hitherto unexplored elements of scientific temper in classical Indian thought. Friends, please understand that our youngsters do not have a good regard for classical Indian thought precisely for this reason, that they are under the impression that it is filled with speculative thinking. On the contrary, we have had scientific elements inbuilt in our classical Indian thought, which I do not have time to go to the details of it, which very well matches with the holistic conception which Dada Bhagavan says, and I presume that I was trying to tell Shailesh ji that we could organize a seminar along these lines encompassing the holistic approach, wherein the classical Indian thinking conceives the science and the metaphysical as one indivisible unity. As Tagore has famously said that we do not believe in nuclear families. Our theories exist in joint families where there is no division between grammar and mathematics and language and natural or physical sciences. Underlying the relativity of physical laws that rules over the nature, he underscores how the physical is influenced by the thinking subject. This is very impressive. He speaks about the relativity of the physical laws, and I don't want to waste time talking about the quantum wherein the relativity of physical laws has been brought about even by the contemporary physics that rules over the nature, and he underscores how the physical has been influenced by the thinking subject, how we determine the nature of the world as it is. His axiomatic position seems to be this: there is an interplay between the real and the relative. The thinking subject is part and parcel of the absolute real, holding an active position in determining the course of events that happen in the world. I quote, this cosmic mechanism functions according to the adjustment among the different phases of your feelings and nature. Therefore, don't disturb the functioning of the nature. If you desire that, let there not be a rain because you are going out for a trip, well, that would trouble the dreams of a farmer who is craving for the rain. I'm employing the very same analogy he has used. You will surely get everything in natural course. For nature makes no mistakes. He reasserts the non-local nature of consciousness, which is very, very interesting for those who are working in the area of consciousness, by devising Yojan Chakra. We are familiar with the six chakras that Patanjali Yoga Sutra speaks about. Then he speaks about another, a seventh chakra called Yojan Chakra, which stands above our head, which links the subjective consciousness with the universal consciousness. This is, he says, it's being placed above our head, connecting the individual consciousness with the absolute consciousness. Here, I'm reminded of the Madhuvidya. Just recently, a few hours ago, I heard a paper on Madhuvidya also, of Brihadaranyaka Upanishad, wherein it has been beautifully brought out how everything in the nature is interdependent. And Dada Bhagavan underscores this interdependence of the relative world and the real world. The world is not a passive material entity. On the contrary, it is pervaded by universal consciousness with which humans can establish a link if he wishes so. In brief, Dada Bhagavan seems to my mind one thinker who reinterprets the Vedantic tradition with this revision of giving due rule to the phenomenal world in the ontic system. Such daring reinterpretations of the ancient Vedantic wisdom deemed necessary to keep the tradition alive. Mere iteration and repetition of what has been said in the classical text, though it is very, very relevant, is insufficient to keep the tradition alive. To bring dynamism to tradition, such innovative philosophizing, contextualizing the ancient wisdom alone would serve the purpose. A function academic philosophers immersed in hailing or critiquing, either we hail a particular text or a philosopher, or we criticize a particular philosopher. And we are immersed in such activity that we are shy of coming up with such innovative thinking. While keeping ourselves busy in building walls between systems, we dare not mix up Vedanta with Jainism. Oh, we are making category mistake. Because we are intended in building walls between systems, we have forgotten that we are also alienating philosophy from the life of the common man. Because the common man wants to see how pragmatically it is meaningful in his life. A synthetic unity of Shramanic thought with Vedanta is yet another innovation. He has been juxtaposed to Jainism and he has brought in the right mindfulness from the Shramanic thinking. Not that we philosophers are unaware of it, but then we are worried about making the category mistakes. We, the academics, dare not bring in Shramanic philosophy into Vedanta, though we are very well aware that it is a type of a philosophy which has successfully tied up the transcendental wisdom at the empirical world. And we are also aware that the basic insights of both Vedanta and the Shramanic, particularly that of Buddhism, are not very different. We fear mixing of the systems. We could take up such innovative ideas as our guiding lights, and I wish that academic philosophers, this is one appeal that the academic philosophers who are assembled here may take, initiate studies in, do research in systematizing Dada Bhagavan's thought. Unless you systematize whatever has been discussed here, it will not survive. In order to survive Dada Bhagavan's philosophy, it has to be systematized, something which is essential to bring it to the academic world. My appeal to the order is to permit the academics to critically view it. One thing that this particular order should take note of is permit Dada Bhagavan's philosophy to be critically reviewed. As I have said in the morning, a philosopher would be tributed if he is permitted to be criticized, which alone would fetch peer sanction, something essential for it to gain a place in academia. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Paneer Selvamji, any short comments, please? If there are, otherwise we are running with the time, so please.
Very clearly, she has expounded Dada Bhagavan's main theme, I would say. I would like to start where she left. Now, this is my view also. When we are making a thinker, talking about a thinker who has contributed for the upliftment of the common man, it is very much essential for us to keep him in the philosophical framework. This means that it is very much essential for us to see how Dada Bhagavan's philosophy, there is a logic, there is metaphysics, there is epistemology and ethics. So all these things are very much essential, which is an essential compound, I would say, to mark a philosopher. And fact is that Dada Bhagavan's philosophy contains all these elements. Now this is a high time for us to go back to Dada Bhagavan and make him a philosopher per se. By what I meant by philosopher per se is to see how in his philosophy or in his writings, let us say, we could see all these aspects. Because as you know, a philosopher's endorsement is on these grounds. One must have epistemology, metaphysics, logic. So these are the essential principles on the basis of which you say, yes, he's a philosopher. And Dada Bhagavan, I have gone through almost all his writings, and I feel that it contains, in all his writing, he has emphasizing a philosophical system, which I think has to be expounded properly. I think that is a need of the hour, because now you, whether you like it or not, a philosopher's stamp is very much essential. Then only, you know, it becomes a beautiful discourse. So that, I think, is a need of the hour, and very rightly she has pointed out. And one thing I would like to say, that very rightly she has pointed out how in Dadaji's philosophy, there is an interconnection between the real and the relative. This is very much essential, because by relative, one can say that it has a connection with the, let us say, empirical world. I don't know whether I am permitted to use the word empirical and the transcendental in Dada Bhagavan's concept. But I would like to say this from the real, when we make a distinction between real and the relative, I would say that it is something which is connected to the empirical and the transcendental. Of course, the integration of spiritual and the physical. This is also something unique in Dada's philosophy. But if you look at, I'll take off a minute. If you look at a Western philosophical discourse, there is always the distinction between the spiritual and the material, and most of the philosophers tie themselves to this material. But in Indian aspect, we see the spiritual part is very much emphasized. But it is the philosophy of Dada Bhagavan, you see the synthesis of both spirit and matter, which is something remarkable. And in that context, one can say it is a holistic approach. There are various, on various grounds, one can say that, we can point one by one and say that on these grounds, we can say that Dada Bhagavan's philosophy is a holistic philosophy. Because yesterday, one of the participants was asking, on what grounds you say that Dada Bhagavan's philosophy is a holistic vision? So I told him, these are the aspects which one has to take into account when you see a philosopher or when you think a social thinker who has contributed substantially for the development of the individual as well as the society. So with this, I'll stop, and if there is some time later,
So thank you very much, and I think we all are agreeing that, say, it's a universal open knowledge. So Dada Bhagavan invites means knowledge, say it's everyone's right to critically examine it or the way you, and we are all one and together. So having said that, within next 30 minutes, I have three more topics, and I request the speakers to be as brief and as specific as possible. I invite Deepak Ananji to have the presentation on art and science of speech and communication, 6 to 8 minutes.
My all-time heartfelt obeisance to Dada Bhagavan, the living holistic science, and today's manifest, His Divine Holiness, Kanu Dadaji, Honorary Chairperson, Coordinator, Professor Puneet Selvam, enlightened speakers and enlightened audience. Remember, the buck stops here at holistic science. So any query from any corner, we are going to get the answer. Time, sky is the limit. But if an ignorant person with no background of spirituality or science or religion, if he could be established and installed with experience in the center of spirituality, we are sure you'll be able to handle this definitely. Okay, speech. The way the total experience of any individual get expressed in his speech, his words, this is how the value of words is there. So, how is the speech formed basically? If we try to see that, it is totally based on our previous code, of my previous intent, the vibrations, what I send, what I feel inside, and which are projected egoistically out of ignorance. Even the words for science and spirituality are projected egoistically in the ignorant state, and that's how it gets culminated and resulted into result, I mean, you get. And as such, we know that the very sound is not the natural result. It is unnatural live matter result. It is called vibhavik parinam. So those codes which are coded, which are formed inside previously, gets converted into shorthand, which normally gets run as our inside speech, which constitutes almost like 7/8 of the total speech. And along with today's changed intent, I say changed intent, the script changes outside, constituting 1/8 of the total speech. And that's how the spoken speech is like tip of the iceberg. Subtle science of speech. Can anybody speak independently? We say no and yes. Why? Yes and no? No. No and yes, both. No, because it is karmic effect, and so it is discharge. and no one has any control. Dada Bhagavan called that as tape record. Speech is like a recorded tape. And yes, because if the intent changes today, the speech changes today. This everybody can experience. So although it is tape record, vocal speech is second discharge. And at this level, it is important that speech is very pivotal in our experience. So how can we change our speech for better? For that, I must know what should be the standard or level of my speech. What should be the nature of my speech? As Dada Bhagavan has brought out so very nicely, it should be sum total of these basic four factors. It should be truthful. It should be beneficial to others. It should be concise. And it should be pleasing to others. Ultimately, it should be syadvad. And the meaning of syadvad means our speech is such that no one is heard from any corner, even slightly. Our friends or our foes both gladly accepts us. So this is the power of speech. Additionally, speech should be free from insistence. It should be as per the situation and as per the situation demands, the number of words it should include. Precisely, it should reveal the principles of life and holistic science. Precisely, it should be free from ownership. It should come out as it comes out, depending on the instrumental cause and the listener. With total mindfulness, it should come out with total mindfulness, with total perception and knowledge. It should be able to eliminate obstacles of the listener, and which enlightens and awakens the soul self. What is the time? It should be concise with a lot of hidden fold qualities. It should be originally pure, virgin, and taintless like natural spring water. It should be such that it does welfare of the speaker and the listener both at the same time. It should be such that it should give lesson, and at the same time, later on, it gives lesson even in the future. You know, every field of knowledge, science, art, it gets expressed through speech. This is the value of speech. And if that speech goes to that highest level, it can awaken our inner soul, it can eliminate our ego, and that's how the speech of enlightened ones goes like that. So, okay. This is important thing. Dada Bhagavan's speech was such, it would remove our obstacles and it is totally free from all contradictions. And that's how he is Jnani Purush. And he has said that the word Dada and Dada Bhagavan is full of fame. In Hindi it is called Yashnam Karma. So anyone who says, even utters this word Dada or Dada Bhagavan, he would be blessed with total success, which we all experience that. Okay, our takeaway is very important. We all learn Sanskrit, Magdi or Prakrit, the Prakrit Bhasha language, because we know that those things are the science, the classical spirituality is available in those language. Dada has said that whoever who wants to know this science as it is, must learn Gujarati. I am one of the example. I did not know Gujarati, all that, but after I came to Dada, I learned Gujarati. And one more last principle of words or speech is, today, although Lord Krishna has spoken Gita Ji 5,000 years back, if you have the skill and knowledge, you can retrieve those words as it is from the atmosphere, but you must have that skill. And that's how ultimately every spoken word needs correction. And that's how we must be doing. We must see that we don't hurt anyone. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Now, looking to the interest of time, there is going to be general body meeting over here at 7. So anyhow, I have to finish my match at 6:45 or 6:50. So we are not taking the questions, straight away going to the two next topics, and Dr. Paneer Selvam is also of the same opinion. So Hetalben, please come fast. And my due apologies to my colleague speakers, because I have to manage so many scientific circumstantial evidences here.
Respected chairperson, coordinators, speakers, participants, namaskar to all. My topic of presentation is self-realization, means realize who am I. Why it is needed in the present day context for acquiring permanent happiness. Now, let us try to understand the most subtle of human experiment as explained by Dada Bhagwan in a simple way. When I say, my name is XYZ, then who am I? When I say, this is my wristwatch, the wristwatch and owner must be separate. When I say, my house, my car, my money, my speech, even I say, my egoism, everything which I refer to as my or mine, then who is I? If my or mine put aside on one side, what would remain on the other side is I. I am aware that I am the mirror, but as a matter of fact, I am not aware who am I. Now, we will try to examine the part of my, everything which falls under my or mine is continuously changing, and also the beginning and the end. When my is continuously changing part, the one who knows that is changing has to be constant or non-changing. Similarly, one who knows that is temporary has to be permanent. Thus, I is there as knower and seer and is permanent. But out of my ignorance, I get two parts mixed up. My is temporary and I is permanent. In other words, we can say the doer and knower cannot be one, but must be separate. So if I say I did it, or even I say I knew it, both cannot be the same, must be separate. One needs to separate I and my with the help of Gnani separator. I and my cannot be fully and completely separated by ourself, as it needs help and grace of one who has fully experience of both separateness. Let us try to understand, I mean in its real perspective is Chetan or pure soul, and my is relative or Pudgal. Pudgal means Puran and Galan. Pudgal is a technical word. Puran means filling in and Galan means emptying out. The pure soul has its own property, so as matter. But as the two elements, Chetan and matter, come together, extra special properties are enlightened in the form of name error. Now let us try to understand how extra special properties do get generated, especially in human format. Now let us try to understand how extra special properties do get generated, especially in human format. When one believes that I am a name bearer, the process of charge and discharge continuously goes on. There is an atomic and molecular configuration of my mind, speech and body from whatever bow generated from time to time. According to Bhav or inner state of existential being, we have attracted atoms and molecules collectively making subtle causal body. And from that, our mind, body, speech are formed to give us results. Now I will like to share my experience in self-realization in few words. Okay. Thank you.
Sorry. Within 10 minutes, we have two more speakers, Bharatananji. Some simple scientific universal tools.
All religions are truly based on scientific principles. The main aim of science is to make life of mankind more comfortable, more convenient by improving external circumstances. This is because living science is at the core of every existence, and all religions are originated from humans only and are mainly for humans who are the only species going against nature. Religion, I say holistic science, aims to make mankind happy within and without, under all kind of circumstances, at any time and at any place, by simply changing the inner vision and understanding of a person. During one's journey of life, one passes through extreme circumstances of happiness and sorrow, favorable and unfavorable, positive and negative. One who can remain at peace, undisturbed, even in extreme and adverse circumstances, is said to have the correct knowledge of understanding of religion. With right vision, one can easily live a happy and blissful life. Let's see the first step to achieve this state. All religions have taught us to have kindness for all, but we human beings have failed miserably to cultivate it in our life. So Dada Bhagwan, the legendary spiritual icon of holisticism, absolute scientist of science of absolutism, guaranteed that if any human being does this inner intent with sincerity for whole life, they definitely will get human form again and also liberation from cycle of birth and death by coming in contact with Jnani. So he asks us to do following prayers daily. In the morning, when you wake up, first thing to do is ask for the strength from the God, whoever you believe, or from the Mother Nature, that, oh God, give me an infinite inner strength so that I do not hurt any living being in this world by my thoughts, by my speech, or by my action. In fact, one must firmly resolve not to hurt any living being during the whole day. Even after following this first step, it may happen that you end up hurting someone knowingly or unknowingly, intentionally or unintentionally. In that case, one need to ask God for forgiveness with sincerity at heart before you go to sleep. That, O pure soul within me, O God within me, you reside within all living beings just as you reside in me. O God, O pure soul, with utmost devotion and oneness, I offer my salutations to you. I confess to you all mistakes that I have committed in ignorant state. I am sincerely and deeply repenting for these mistakes and ask for your forgiveness. Please forgive me and grant me the strength never to repeat such mistakes. O God, please bless us all with such grace that we attain oneness with you all the time. This simple, fundamental first step of all religions has a very great power of transformation and brings about the change far more than an atomic bomb. Now let me give you one practical example of this thing. A year before, I was in Europe and the discourse was in one city. And after that, I have to travel to another city, which is about 3 hours drive away. So after the discourse was over, the person who gave me ride in the car, he asked me, "Ki Swamiji, one of my friends, we are studying together before 14 years in university, his house is on the way after 1 hour, and he has invited me for tea. So if you don't mind, we can go there and we'll reach half an hour later." I said, "Okay, no problem."
Now, then what he did, he told that his friend, and he told him that, of course, I am coming, but with me, my spiritual master is also coming. So he said, okay, you are most welcome. Now, when we reach his home, they both welcomed me very well, greeted me very well. And when I was sitting on sofa, he came to me and told me, I am not interested in religion, so please don't talk anything religious with me. I said, okay, I will not talk anything religious, but I will talk scientific. So both were so happy. Then what happened? They were talking. So they were sitting about 7-8 feet away from me on the carpet, and I was sitting on the sofa. So after 15 minutes, there was some break. So at that time, I asked that person, that guy, he was a mechanical engineer, and that girl was a fine arts graduate. I asked them, you want to be happy in your life? So they both turned to me, stared at me, and said, yes, definitely. Then I told them, I can give you a master key, which my master Dada Bhagwan gave me. So attentively they came nearer, about 2-3 feet. Okay, give us. I can give you, but for that, you will have to spare 4 to 5 minutes daily. They confirmatively said, yes, we will. Are you giving me promise? Yes, promise. Then I gave them the first center, morning prayer. I don't want to hurt any living being in this world by my thoughts, by my speech, or by my action. And I asked them, even if you will ask for this strength, you will have firm determination within, then also it will happen, you will hurt somebody. So for that, before you sleep, you ask for this forgiveness. So then that girl asked me, why to ask for apology? Why to ask for forgiveness? I will never, in India, nobody will ask me this type of question. But she asked me, why to ask for apology? Now what to reply her? Then I told her, the dress you are wearing, say you are in picnic outside, whole day you are outside, and in the evening when you will come back, what you will do? You will change your dress. And then you will put it in the laundry bag. Correct? You will put it in the laundry bag. Why? Because your dress is getting dirty. Same way, when you hurt somebody by your thoughts, by your speech, or by your action, your inner dress is getting dirty. So for that, also you require something. So she got convinced. Then after some time, they both say, okay, we'll do this prayer. We'll do this thing. This is, the guy told me, this is not religious, and I am convinced and I can do it. This is logical. Then after some time, that girl asked me, okay, you were telling me, okay, you will not talk anything religious, this is not religious, but how come it is scientific? How it is scientific? Another question. So I told her, okay, you know Newton's third law? Newton's third law is actions and reactions are equal and opposite. Here, during the whole day, what is your action? I don't want to hurt any living being. That is our action. And it is sincere action because in the night before you sleep, you are asking for the apology. So as a result, what Mother Nature will do? Mother Nature will give you such circumstances that nobody will hurt you. And when nobody will hurt you, what will remain with you? Happiness. So this is a simple scientific thing that Dada Bhagwan gave us. And after 1 year, when they contacted me again, they were not able to meet me at that time. But I asked them, are you doing it? Both said, yes, we are doing it. Then I asked, how many days you forget? Not a single day. So then again I asked, you have any benefit? What she told me? My inner strength is increasing day by day. So I don't understand what she will understand inner strength. So I asked, what is inner strength? So she replied me, before, for small thing, I was getting disturbed, and now I am not getting disturbed. And the guy told me that I can feel that my positivity is increasing day by day. So this science, this is a holistic science, revealed by Dada Bhagwan, it's very, very effective. There are 2-3 points, but next time we'll talk. Okay? Thank you very much.
So, thank you very much. We have the last speaker, Geeta Ben Desai, and then Dr. Paniriselvam, and Chairman's remarks. Please come.
All the scholars, Swamiji, on the dais and off the dais, Jai Sachidanand, we will be going with a happy, harmonious, stress-free inner living through 9 priceless diamond, or you can say 9 divine course of conduct. Now, history of 9 divine course of conduct. Before getting self-realization at Surat station in 1958, the holistic scientist Sri A.M. Patel, popularly known as Dada Bhagwan, for more than 40 years led his life with 14 course of conduct, out of which he gave us 9. Who is Dada Bhagwan? The picture we see is of Sri A.M. Patel. In him had manifested Dada Bhagwan, fully manifested God. That's what we mean when we say Dada Bhagwan and gave obedience to. Now, science behind this projection or prayer. Today's mind, speech and body are the fruits or effect of the past seeds, and fruits are the results. It may not change. So what need to change is the cause or the seed. 9 course of conduct will consequently and subsequently will change our behavior. This scientific approach of cause and effect, the inner weakness will slowly and slowly will be removed. It is for whom? 9 divine code of conduct is essence of holy scriptures and is for everyone. It covers the vast spectrum of our daily interaction with other, as well as related to our personal health, food, and how to be stress-free. The first code of conduct, not to hurt, causing someone to hurt, or supporting someone hurting, even slightly, the ego of any living being through mind, speech, and body. The second, not to hurt, causing someone to hurt or supporting someone, even slightly, the foundation or viewpoint of any religion. The third one, not to enact any verbal wrangle, misdeed, misconduct, or showing disregard to any preacher, monk, nun, or religious head, or anyone we learn from. The fourth, not to dislike or hate any living being to the slightest extent, neither cause anyone nor support anyone doing it. The fifth code of conduct, to restrain from speaking harsh, hurtful language, any sticky language, to anyone, to speak soft, sweet language to others, despite of others biting, bitter, egoistic, and scathing language. Now we'll go to the sixth one. To restrain from committing the carnal deeds, desire, or gesture, or thought of perverted sensuality, or passion towards any gender, masculine, feminine, or neuter. To be free from the cobweb of Cupid. Now the seventh one, that is also very important. To control temptation of regarding in any relish or flavor of food. To take well-balanced, wholesome food of 6 tests. The eighth one, not to enact any inflammatory speech, verbal wrangle, misdeed, or misconduct, causing someone to do so or supporting someone doing so to any creature directly or indirectly, living or dead. The essence of ninth code of conduct to be instrumental in establishing real well-being in the world. Yog upyog paropkaraya. Conclusion: the power of bhava or wish or projection or prayer has been very well documented in many literatures of the world. Conclusion of this nine priceless diamond: they are also like a pratikraman or repentance, since we are accepting our past mistakes and we are asking for inner strength not to repeat again. The world is fortunate to have them, especially since it is scientific and by experiment have been proved to get one of the highest result in one's life towards the self-realization. Thank you so much. Jai Sachidanand.
So thank you. These were some of the highlighting points which Dada Bhagwan's holistic science brings out. Now I invite Dr. Paneer Selvam to have his remarks.
I'll be very, very brief. Now two or three points which I would like to highlight. One of the significant contribution, I would say, is Dada Bhagwan's approach towards speech. Indian philosophical tradition used the word vak. And Dada Bhagwan has raised one important question, namely, that can we speak independently? This is a very, very important issue, which, one may, you know, when you are reading his writings, one may ignore that, no? If you give a casual reading, but, you know, it has got a lot of implications. Now, the thing is, I am a student of philosophy, I would like to see this from a philosophical perspective. Plato argued in one of his dialogues one of his dialogues says he always prefers speech. Why? He says speech is more important than something which is written. And he says, why? Because in speech, the other person is there. Okay? The other is there. So there is a dialogue that can take place. So if I say something wrong, then my good friend Arish Bhai would correct me. No, you're wrong. But once I write down something and keep it, if I write a letter, send an email to him, then if I make some mistakes or something said wrongly, then I am not there to explain to him, no, I didn't mean that one. So Plato long back said that speech is, in fact he says, written words are like fatherless children. Because there is nobody to protect the words. But in speech it is not like that, we are there. But I am just seeing this from philosophical perspective. But what is important is, when Dada Bhagwan talks about the significance of speech, he means in speech the other is there. So we should not hurt, because you can't have a monologue. No? When somebody is there, Shuklaji is there, when I speak to him, then there is a dialogue. So this means while I'm entering into a dialogue, this is my problem, I always move from the mic. So when we are having a dialogue, the other person's values must be taken into consideration. This is very, very important. So, in fact, he said, as somebody has very rightly said, speech is like a tape recorder. This is a very beautiful statement. It is a metaphorical usage, in fact. So, this means our speech should not hurt the other. This is what it implies. This, I would say, has got a profound philosophy. So this means, he says, stop misusing speech. Once again, I don't want to dwell on this more, because there is a one Western thinker by name Habermas, who also talks about the significance of speech. So I try to compare this with Dada Bhagwan, and there are a lot of implications. Perhaps I can write a detailed paper on this. Then the last part is a transformation. This is the most significant contribution, I would say, which our Dada Bhagavan has made, because he talks about the individual transformation as well as the social transformation. This is very much essential. So that is the reason why in all his writing, he stresses the need for the individual to transfer, I mean transformation. So this transformation will take us to the society's or social transformation. So this is very rightly our last speaker has beautifully pointed out the 9 codes of conduct, which are very, very essential. They are simple. Each and every one of us can easily practice that. So if you take into account the entire contribution of Dada Bhagavan, one can say, and also she said that Dada Bhagavan is nothing but his philosophy is nothing. We can call him as a fully manifested God. I would say he is God on earth, a Jivan Mukta, whose contribution is something remarkable. And one more sentence. I am always fascinated by the term which he has been using in Man is a Gust of Nature. This is something, when I read it, I was astonished. Because nowadays we talk about cosmological view. We talk about, we move from the anthropological to cosmological. Now this aspect is something which he anticipated long back. In the West we talk about deep ecology and all, like Arrhenius and all that one. But it is very much available in Dadaji's presentation. So very rightly one can say, as she said, fully manifested God. And with one more statement, with that I couldn't conclude. We can call him, and I would like to call him as a common man's philosopher. Because the common man needs guidance. He has to be liberated. So Dadaji's philosophy has got a social relevance, and I am grateful to our Shailesh ji for giving me this nice opportunity, and I thank you all. Thank you very much.
In fact, we are privileged to have you here, and we are very, very grateful to have, and we are one again. We are one, and Dada's one family. Professor Sohanraj Tatir for the chairman's remarks, please.
It's my great pleasure to have a chair among our all respectable Swamijis in this discourse. All our Swamijis, Swami Shaileshananji, Swami Mineshananji, Swami Kantyananji, Swami Deepakananji, Swami Bhartananji, and Geeta Desai Behan, Hetal Patel Behan, and Nair Madam, and the Dr. Pani Shelvam and Dr. Shaileshananji. Every speaker tried from his angle to prove Dada Bhagwan philosophy as a holistic science for the welfare of individual as well as for the welfare of whole cosmos. So that way we can say that Dada's philosophy is a role model for ideal living and thinking, because nothing is remaining behind it, because it starts from the distinction of the real and relative. And the start is there. First you start question to yourself, who am I? Then the things start. As Dr. Pani Shelvam has dealt, he is a man philosopher. It's a great thing Dada has actually cared, or he has the compassion for every creature of this living being, not of the man, whole cosmos. That's why Dada say, I will be attaining the salvation at last, and I will take first everybody to have the salvation. So that way, all the 5 agyas of the Dada and the distinction of the real and relatives, and the thing is that air is human. Every time we can have some errors, but Dada has given the solution of the purification also, that is of Samayik, Alochna, Pratikraman, Pratyakhyan, about which at length this had been told. So that way we should have this philosophy in our life, and if we follow this philosophy from right beginning, that means we should take the Gyan of Dada, and if we follow it in the real sense, we can start transforming ourselves, and as the talk of the ego is told, the good ego, discharge ego, positive ego and negative ego, so by slowly our negative ego will go on diminishing, and positive ego, as we are in relative world, it is essential sometimes also, so the discharge ego will functioning. So that way, this is a holistic, the sense that it never actually remains anywhere. There is a reply of every question. Question of individual to the cosmos, reply is there in Dada's philosophy. So on another thing, actually it gives us the solution of all the present problem of the whole universe. We can take the problem of the individual, and there is solution is there for the politically, for our these families, and for our nation, for and all types of our cultural this and clashes also, because Dada's this all the things which he has done, that came from his inner soul. He's a divine soul, he's a pure soul. That was the thing, came from intuition, and with the intuitional things when come, it gives the real solution, because at the level of our intellect, there are some differences that are there, but when some things come from the our, say, inner soul, pure soul, then the things will be always pure, and as when our this negative ego will go on vanishing, then definitely we will come closer to the happiness, which is the ultimate aim of our everybody's life. As Swamiji has told, that they didn't want to hear anything about the religion, but when in another way, when he make them understood scientifically, then they came to him and they responded and they replied. Every day they are following what has been told by the Swamiji's. So that way, from any dimension, if we take the Dadaji's all this philosophy, then from we can make our life happy, our home happy, and we can start doing our self-realization, which is our main motto of the life. So that way, and another thing, whatever rituals we do, whatever feelings we have from any caste, creed, or any language, any problem, it doesn't affect at all, because it gives a real knowledge of ourself, knowledge of our universe, and it is a solution-oriented philosophy. The main thing today, the philosophy that will be alive, or that will be fruitful, which gives the solution of the problems which are arising in, say, this whole cosmos, and there are all potentiality in Dada's philosophy to give the all type of the solution. So we had a great our spiritual discourses, everybody enjoyed, and we hope that with these discourses, we can know much about the philosophy of Dada Bhagwan, and we should try that it should conduct in us, and we can take more and more other details from the Swamis, because these all are dedicated throughout the life, and every time they are preaching at the end, another thing, they follow what Dada has told in their own life. The main thing is that the Dada's philosophy should come in our conduct, then we will start realizing ourselves, which is the main motto of the life. So thanks to all, and my all gratitude to respected Swamiji, Shaleshanandji, Panish Elvam, and sister Geeta Desai, and sister Hetal Ben, and Nair Madam also. Everybody tried very nicely. All are very, enlightened persons, and they have talked in a very nice way, and everybody tried at his super perfection to prove Dada's philosophy as a holistic science for our ideal living, thinking. Vasudev Kutumbakam is type of the short model everybody has tried to take from the Dada's philosophy. Thank you, all of you.
So,
Thank you. We end this session here, but it will have the continuing things in future. Thank you very much. Yeah, tomorrow we have another round table on mysteries of human life and universe from 11:15 to 1:15. That will be the mysteries of human life and universe. Thank you very much.